My name is Ken Ross, and I'm the lead demoer today. And this is Paul Lawton, and he's the today he's my assistant. Sometimes I'm his assistant. But you want to say a few words about yourself?
Sure. My name is Paul Lawton, and in 1965, I was attending Virginia Tech. At Virginia Tech, I took the only course they had in computer programming. It was a course in Fortran. After I did that, I decided my career was going to be in computer programming. So I spent my entire career in computer programming, worked for great companies like IBM, Apple, Logitech, Atari, and I'm retired. Now I'm here telling you how much fun I had in my career.
Okay. So before we start, welcome to the Computer History Museum 1401 demo. The 1401 was actually introduced in 1959, and it's been known maybe as the Model T Ford of computers. By 1965, over half the computers in the world were IBM family 1401s. By the end of the 1960s, there were about 15,000 of them in use. But before we start the demo, I'd like to take you back in time, back to the summer of 1962. JFK was president, and the Cold War was the hot topic on the news. I had just finished my freshman year at MIT, and had secured a summer programming job at a mid-sized department store chain in Detroit, Michigan. The company was called Federal Department Stores. And Federals had just installed two state-of-the-art 1401s, very similar to these. And there are two machines in this room. And they were going to use the computers to do basic accounting tasks like inventory control, payroll, sales analysis. And that's the way computers were used in the early 1960s. There was no interaction, online ordering, anything like that. It was all tabulating basic information. And the room I worked in was very similar to this. This represents a computer room from the 1960s. You can hear the loud air conditioning because these computers put out a lot of heat. You're standing on a raised floor, and we'll explain and show you why. And I guess there's a little bit of smell of oil because all these machines are very mechanical as well as electronic. So in the middle of the room that I work were two 1401s. You know, this is the card reader card punch. So this is the way information gets into the machine. This is the CPU here. You want a CPU here, the control panel, and we actually interact with these machines physically back in those days, not like we do today. We have all these switches. This is the 1403 printer, and it was the most advanced printer of its time, and we're going to be showing you that. And last but not least, are these 729 tape drives. And again, we're going to be demoing all these and telling you more about them. Oh, and he just started them up. In addition to just a computer, there were a lot of other machines that were really needed to run jobs. So at one end of the room where I worked, there were about 20 key punch machines that are like these. Women were sitting them with stacks of paper. They would be timesheets, sales tickets, or inventory control tags. And of course, back in the early 1960s, women did basically all of the key punching. In addition to that key punching, there are these other ancillary machines. So we have the unit record equipment. You'd need to collate, sort, tabulate, interpret, and they were run. These plug boards are the programs for this unit record equipment. This is a program. I don't have any idea what it does, but it would typically read an 80-column punch card and might tabulate a field of numbers. It might print or interpret or do something like that. So the program library before our computer was racks full of these cards. My favorite machine, which we used a lot of, which is the sorter.
Take it and pass it down.
When you're processing punch cards, everything needed to be sorted. If you're doing payroll, you typically sort by Social Security number or department. If you're doing sales analysis, you might sort by product ID. And we all got very familiar with the process of sorting cards. Paul, you want to?
Going to sort first?
Huh?
Going to sort.
Sort.
So basically, this machine can sort on one column of an 80-column card. And there's a little setting here to tell us which column we're going to sort on. So it reads the information in the column and dumps it into the appropriate slot here. So here we go. So you can see it's reading them and dropping them into the proper sort. It's doing that at 1,000 cards a minute. Now, back in the era when this machine was used, there might be, let's say you're doing Social Security numbers. Now, since you're doing one column at a time, how many sorts would that take? 9, right? Now, suppose you were the IRS and you had 200 million customers and you had to sort on all the Social Security numbers. You can imagine how many machines it would take and how many people it would take. That was really full employment back in the day. Now, once you sort on one column, in order to maintain the sort, you have to take these cards out in a very special way. So now I've got this sort, and if I wanted to do the next column, I'd move the pointer over and sort them again. We're not going to do that, but that's the way it works.
Okay, so yeah, we all got very familiar with managing large decks of cards, and for those of you that are programmers, programs were written on these decks of cards. How many are programmers in this room? Okay, so if you were a good programmer, I was, I'm sure Paul was, that you'd make sure you kept sequence numbers in the last 5 columns of the card in case the deck got dropped and you needed to sort your program back into the original sequence. So just continuing on with the narrative, IBM actually began the development of the 1401 in 1957. The goal was to create an entry-level machine that rented for about $2,500 a month. And that's about $15,000 a month in today's dollars. And the reason for the $2,500 a month is that was sort of the average that people used to pay to rent all these old card accounting machines. For the rental price, and people rented the computers back then, they didn't really buy them, you had your IBM reps, you had a month-to-month bill, you could upgrade your computer, you could downgrade your computer. If you decided that you wanted hardware multiply divide, which happened to be an option on this machine, you call up your IBM rep, they'd bring out a few of these cards, they'd put them in, and lo and behold, your monthly bill would go up by a few $100 a month. So IBM was actually able to achieve the cost and reliability goals by incorporating the solid-state modules. You want these solid-state cards. Pass these around here. Each of these cards has a few transistors on it. I'm not an engineer. This card has, it looks like, 6 transistors. There's about 3,000 of these things in each 1401. And as you're well aware, a modern chip would have 1 billion transistors in it, or probably more. So this was very advanced, but the machines were very reliable, amazingly. So in addition to the solid-state cards, IBM incorporated, and as I said earlier, a state-of-the-art 1403 printer. And we're going to demonstrate later why this was the most advanced printer on the market, but just take my word for it that it was. Now, IBM shipped the first 1401 to Time Life in 1960. And at that time, Time Life had 40 million punch cards, 40 million punch cards that it used to keep track of its accounting information and its mailing list information. And to give you a sense for that, 40 million, this standard box of punch cards is 2,000 cards. So 40 million punch cards is about 20,000 boxes of cards, which actually I computed to be a stack about 7 miles high. So it's a lot of punch cards. Now, with the advent of magnetic tape like this, it really changed the way companies could process larger volumes of data. This reel of magnetic tape can contain about between 50,000 and 200,000 cards. So Time Life's entire inventory of information could be contained on a couple of hundred reels of tape. But of course, in addition to the couple of hundred reels of tape, you probably needed another couple of hundred reels of tape as backup, probably off-site. Now, if you think about it, we have 40 million punch cards. Each card has 80 characters of information on it. And you're a good mathematician. How many total characters of information does that represent?
Oh, a few gigabytes.
A few gigabytes. It's actually 3.2 gigabytes. So you can store all of that information on this actually obsolete 4 gigabyte thumb drive. And it really illustrates the way Moore's law has come applied to storage as well as computation. And last, before we actually get into running the programs, I'd like to talk about the processor a little bit. So the 1401 stored information in BCD, binary coded decimal, character by character. Each character position has 6 bits of information, so there were no lower case, just uppercase, 1 word mark bit and 1 parity bit. And information was stored in variable length fields. So if you wanted to store a 20-digit number, you could store a 20-digit number, and it was delimited by the word mark bit. So you would address the low order position, and the computer would read forward until it hit a word mark. So that's a lot different than a modern computer, which would have a 64-bit register. You can store 200 character strings, 20 character numbers. The cycle time on this machine is 87,000, right? 87K cycle time. And to add 2 10-digit numbers took about a half a millisecond. The other thing that's important is information was stored in core memory. So, here, you got that one? So, core memory are little teeny donuts, the magnetic iron donuts with an X, 2 wires that go between them. This is just a representation. My hands are, this box here actually has 140 characters of core memory on it. It's actually 1 tweet of memory. And this little vial has hundreds of these little ferrite cores in it. And I'll pass this around. You guys maybe can pass this around. Interestingly enough, core memory back then was very expensive. A character, a byte, I'll use the term, although byte wasn't used back then, character would cost $5. Today, that's $30. Is that right? Yes. Today, it's $30. Okay, I have a new 64-gigabyte iPhone. Let's see, 64 gigabytes times $30, it's about $1.8 trillion of memory if I do the translation. So, let's see, I think that's really all for the processor. I think we're ready to do a demo.
Where is that little core memory you had?
This one?
The
box, the tweet?
The little box, yeah.
The black one. Yeah, don't let it.
Where is that?
Here, he's got it.
Hold that up for a second. Just this little one here. Let me hold it. This has 140 characters of core memory, those little teeny cores. It was used as a print buffer. Anybody know what 140 characters is today? 1 tweet. So we have here in my hand 1 tweet of old memory.
Okay, last but not least.
Confess.
I need you, Paul. This is a USB cable. Everybody's seen a USB cable. You want to show them a USB cable from 1962?
Take this and pass it around.
Yeah, we're not worried about anybody walking off with that. I think it weighs about 50
heavy.
Pounds.
You can take it if you can.
Okay, you want to grab a volunteer?
Okay, well basically what we're going to do next is demonstrate the key punch. And in the spirit of the era that we're in, the 1960s, women did all the key punching. So I'd like a woman volunteer to come up and help me demonstrate. And you are our volunteer. Come on in. Well, we'll teach you. Walk over and have a seat in this chair over here. Okay, now up here we have a bunch of blank cards. And what we need to do is we need to feed it down into the punch station. So there's a key called feed.
Okay.
So you press the feed key. Okay. Now it's down here, but we still need to register it into the punch station, so hit register. Now, what I'd like you to do is type your first name, space, last name. It's all uppercase, and don't make a mistake.
There's no backspace key on a key punch.
I'm sorry?
Is it uppercase now?
Is it
uppercase?
It's all uppercase. There is no lowercase. There's only 42 possible characters that you can punch. Did you punch your first name, space, last? Okay, so now hit release. Now, remember I said don't make a mistake? Let's suppose you got out to column 51 and you made a mistake.
Ooh.
Well, you got two choices. You can either redo the whole card or you can duplicate what you've already done. So let's simulate that. So hit the feed key again and hit the register key, REG. Now, hold down the duplicate. So what we're doing is we're reading from here and punching over here. Now, if you had made a mistake in column 51, you could duplicate all the way out to column 50 and then continue to type. So we're done. So hit release, register, release, and register.
One thing I'll say is after we finish the demo, we stay around, and anybody that wants to punch their name in a card, and we're going to run the big print program to print it out, you can do it. So
now we've given you a demonstration of how this works. You've proved yourself competent. So you can go down to our personnel department, get a job for 80 cents an hour. And here you go, Betsy. And I'm going to keep this for a little while.
You're going to go run big print?
Right now?
Huh?
Now?
Yeah, sure. Okay, we're going to move down this way because we're going to now be running on the German machine, which is the one that's actually operational today. Yeah, you got the white deck. Okay. So you can watch the cards go in and watch them pop out there. Hold on a second. Are you ready? Okay, we're ready.
Before I do this, I want to tell you a little bit about this machine. Basically, this is the software. This is a program. And this is the only way of getting programs or data in is through this card reader. Now, there's no operating system in this machine. So everything that a program needs has to be in this deck. Now, when I press the load key, it's going to read this first card in. Just the first card, and it's going to transfer to the instructions on this card. This is called a bootstrap card. The bootstrap card has to be responsible for reading in the rest of the program. So basically, put the cards into the reader, and we have this weight to weight the cards down so they'll feed better. Then press a couple of buttons, and then I'm going to hit the load key. And you can see it's reading the cards in and dropping them into a slot there. Now it's read the data card.
The cable that you took back.
Yeah.
The wires were so big. Was that all coaxial cable?
Just plain copper wire.
Then why would they need such a very low voltage signal?
Yeah.
Why do they need the wires can carry 25 amps?
I don't know the answer to that. But somebody will be here. I'll get the answer for you. Okay, so that's the big print. You know, reading the cards in. We want to talk a little bit about the printer now.
Show everybody what we did here. We took Betsy's card with her first name, last name, and printed it in big letters. Thus, it's called Big Print. So, Betsy?
So we said earlier that this was the most advanced printer on the market, and I'd like to explain why. Here, you want to hold it? So all of the other printers in the early 60s were configured so that each print position, there might be a spinning wheel with a character set or little arms that might have gone up and down, but the result of that is that the printing that you saw from a computer was wavy. It was really awkward. IBM developed the 1403 with this horizontal print chain. You want to hold it up? So that chain spins at 90 inches a second. It's got five copies of the character string. And as you'll see, and as you can see, the printing is very high quality. It's very level. And it was very good for printing forms, paychecks, and things like that. We're about to crank, let's see. You want to crank up powers?
Okay.
So, one of the experiences I remember it had to do with designing a paycheck form, writing the program, ordering like thousands of pre-printed forms that four-part carbon paper, and worrying that my program wasn't going to align correctly with the printer. Or when I'm loading the checks into the printer, there's a process to get them aligned, and you push the button and it starts printing lots of checks. And what if you've done it wrong? You print 10,000 paychecks that are not aligned right. So Paul's going to run a program that's going to really compute powers of two. It's just going to exercise the printer. But it's going to... I've lifted the sound cover on this so that you can hear the full beauty of the printer. But in reality, I'm going to put it back down now. You'll see. Still makes a lot of noise. So when you were working in a computer room in the 1960s, you know, two or three printers going all the time, it was a pretty noisy place. Okay, so let's see, what else I was going to say about the printer. What is it, 2 to the 238?
328th, I think.
This computes 2 to the 328th, and the logic behind that is that this only has 132 print positions, and that's 2 to the 238th.
328.
So the last part of the demo is let's talk about the tape drive. I'll start it up. You want to go?
Okay.
You want to start it and talk?
Now the tape that you're seeing spinning here is, it's Mylar tape. Remember the old VCRs? This tape is very similar to what was in your VCRs. Now, on your VCR, the way it worked, it moved reel to reel. So one reel turned and it pulled the tape across. However, on this machine, we want to start it and stop it very, very quickly. And if we were to do that reel to reel, there'd just be too much momentum. So it would end up stretching the tape. So we had this way of buffering the tape. There's a motor here that is pulling the tape across the read write head, but it's pulling on free tape. Now what's happening is we have vacuum columns here, and the vacuum is sucking the tape down. And you see there's a hole at the top and a hole at the bottom. Well, when the tape crosses one of those holes, it tells this reel to either feed or take up, depending on which hole is covered. So that's the way we get this to operate in this manner. Now, another thing about this is that when the job is done, you want to be able to quickly unload the tape. And so that means we need to do what's called a high-speed rewind. And I'm going to demonstrate that. Now you can see these are doing very high speed rewinds. However, we don't want to go at that same speed all the way off the end of the reel. So at some point it's going to stop and go into a slow speed rewind.
We're not going back here.
Now, one more thing about this tape. Sometimes operators make mistakes. Let's suppose you had a very valuable read tape, had your data on it, and then it was writing to another tape. Well, sometimes the operator might make a mistake. He put your valuable tape on the drive that's going to be writing. So there's a way of protecting yourself. There's this ring in here called the right ring. So no ring, no right. So if the operator happens to mount it on the wrong drive, you're safe. So very, very good idea. Another interesting thing about tapes in the era, IBM advised their customers, when you're creating a valuable tape, make two copies of it. Why would they do that? Backup. And why two backups? One backup you keep on site, and another backup you keep off site. And today, we probably back up to the cloud. Hopefully at the other end of the cloud, they're doing something like this too.
Yeah, hopefully. The last thing I'd say about this and the right rings and the tape, that when you were running a job, when you were running payroll, there was a lot of different steps, a lot of manual intervention, a lot of operator instructions. So when you wrote a payroll system, you wrote a number of programs, but you also wrote a run book that was could be pretty thick with flowcharts. It said, mount this tape, punch these cards, dismount the tape, mount another tape. So one of the things that you saw with the high-speed rewind was it made the computer operation more efficient because you could rewind the tape really fast, take it off, mount another tape. There was a lot of that went on, and of course a lot of errors that went on. So I think that's sort of the end of the formal demo.
Well, there's a couple other little facts.
Go ahead.
If you put your cards on tape, there's a way you can sort using tape, and you can sort 50 times faster than you can with that machine. So that was another good reason to buy these machines. Another interesting fact is, you probably all got these in your pockets. How much power do you take? Anybody know? About 1 watt. How much power do you think this machine takes? When it's fully operational, 12,000 watts. We've got two of them in this room, 24,000 watts. So some people say we turn them both on, the lights in Mountain View dim a little.
Okay.